Studio ONL, which he runs together with his partner Ilona Lenard. From 2000 to 2016, he was a professor of digital design methods and head of the Hyperbody group at TU Delft. Kaas has worked on many well-known projects, including the Saltwater Pavilion, the Web of North Holland, the A2 Cockpit Showroom in Utrecht, the Balna Mixed-Use Cultural Center in Budapest, and the LIWA Tower in Abu Dhabi. Also, many of you will know his book, Towards a New Kind of Building, A Designer's Guide to Non-Standard Architecture, where he explains the paradigm shifts from standard to non-standard architecture and from static to dynamic environments. Currently, he's writing a new book with the title Interacting Components. And what I can also recommend very much, Kaas, is your great TEDx talk, which can be found on YouTube, which I found very inspiring. So again, thank you very much for joining us here today with a keynote lecture with the title Interactive and Proactive Environments, Participatory Design Instruments. Please go ahead.
Okay, so I will start with this word, this little phrase, machining emotion. That's something, this is a project we did in 2005 in Dubai. It's robotic painting. You see the logo, and the logo was painted by the robot as well. It was an event in Dubai Design Week, and actually it's exemplary for the whole process, the way we work. Actually, the way we work since we did our earliest projects in the 90s, like Sculpture City and Water Pavilion. So the system is actually like this. We have a concept, we have a sketch, an emotional input. We derive data from that input and use it as parameters in the algorithm. Then we drive the robot, and the robot paints in many layers different versions of that algorithm. The algorithm contains fractals in this case. So we end up with a very complex picture. In this case, it's a piece of art. Also, the frames were robotically produced. And then after the algorithm, you have the production and the assembly. And you will see this in a moment in this image, that it assembles together as a piece of art. So we made many of those paintings here. Well, next, interactivity. That is one of the promises I got you to talk about interactivity. The general title I changed into building relations, because that is basically the basis of everything. Also for interactivity, you have to build relations between people and people, between people and things, and between things and things. The first real project we did was Saltwater Pavilion, where we built relations between the people, how they move in the building, and how they interact using sensor boards to change the conditions of that environment. For example, trigger a water tunnel to go into the underground world of the Saltwater Pavilion. And it's under that twisted floor that squeezes out this water. And you actually are kept perfectly dry under this. Farther down, you see some strange phenomenon, which is actually part of a sketch that was materialized into structure. Keeping up this floor, which is a twisted floor on top of that underworld, so this is called the sensorium, where we built a virtual world as projection all around you, as the sky, so to say. The building in itself is closed, except for that piece in front of you, which is it's a balloon that blows up every 50 minutes and inflates again. So it's actually to trigger that idea that this building is alive. It has a life of its own, and it's defined, the behavior is defined by algorithms and by the people intervening with those algorithms through sensor boards. So sensor boards, they could actually tweak the sounds, they could tweak the light conditions you could play with the virtual environments, actually navigate virtual environments. So the lady on the left is now on one of those sensor boards. You see the lights changing and shifting instantly. I'm not sure if there's more on this video. It was a very old one. Okay, let's continue quickly. The whole geometry of the building is driven by curves. So we have here 16 curves, 8 for the exterior, 8 for the interior. And these curves are actually materialized by stretching ruled surfaces between them. This is the look into those curves. It's 3D, of course. You look into the curvatures, and that's exactly what has been made. So here you see the same curvatures back in the steel structure. And this is one of the most important images, actually, because it actually relates us to the one who has the machines. So the whole actually issue about our work is we have to relate to those machines. We have to know the machines, what they are capable of. And this steel manufacturer, which was Meyers Stalbo, actually was a key factor in achieving our goals. So the promise was the smooth geometry, but now you have to make it. And this guy was really instrumental in that. So this is one of the shots of that interior. You see the red piece is the sensor board, and you see a different virtual environment projected on the ceiling. And if you see the glass fibers, which are the exact representations of the original splines, defining the geometry. This is the program actually that drives the color schemes of those glass fibers. And the data were coming from a weather station on the sea. And we interpreted the raw data into MIDI signals. And each MIDI signal gets a value, and that value represents a certain light condition. So you have all the glass fibers represented here. To make a building, to make those curvatures, we have to actually, what we did, we developed an algorithm, basically, a system, a procedure, an autolisp routine in this case, to actually communicate our geometry to the machines. So the curvatures were divided in segments, and the segments were then rolled in the machine to reach that curvature. So this was the moment when we knew we don't have to make 3D models anymore. We have to write procedures. We have to write scripts. We have to produce the data that the machines will understand. So it was this machine, our computer-to-machine communication, that became the basis of our work since. This is 25 years ago. Here you see the overview, the result of the sculpture, basically. It's much more of a sculpture than of a building. You don't see windows, really. But there are doors, exit doors, but they are more cut out of the skin. And this was also when we started to think of a building having a skeleton and an interior skin, where you have the virtual reality projections and the exterior skin as one unified system, not as separate systems. Here you see the skin meeting the rocks and a close-up of the skin. From there, reading books like Animated Form also by Greg Lin, we were thinking we should not stop the movement. We should actually start thinking of buildings that keep moving in real time, which is, I think, a very logical consequence of working with animating software. So you can freeze it and build it, you can interact with it, but the next step would really be live with it. So you don't hear the sound, I do, I think I do. Can you still hear me when I put, can you still hear me? Yeah, okay. So actually what we did here is to design a game inside that building that moves and the building that is proactively proposing you situations, proposing you a different geometry, and then interacting with that as a sort of gameplay. You are in the game. This was also the time that we were looking at movies like Existence. You know, probably the movie, which I think one of the most important movies to relate reality to virtual reality. So that was our goal. And we were assuming that we would get clients to actually do this for us, but not many came. Here at the Biennale 2000, we had the central room in Italian pavilion, and I was explaining here to Italian television how it works. Basically, the movement of such a building would work with pistons. We just need a number of pistons, very simple, to make it work. It's not complicated, actually. It might be complex on purpose, but not complicated. So it could easily be done. But then the question is, how do you find clients for buildings that actually move? So this has been our challenge, and it's still a challenge that we have to overcome somehow. We did other experiments, some for Pompidou, 2003, non-standard architectures. We built a thing that actually walked alive using pesto muscles and using sensors to interact with it. And that was quite successful. Although we had to limit the movements due to some constraints set by the Centre Pompidou, but it could twist, it could hop, it could do many things. The interior tells the story. Actually, you send pressure to the muscles, and the muscles contract or extend. And if they work together properly, like what I usually say, like birds in a swarm, because they have to operate as a system, as a swarming system, then you can actually trigger all those different movements. I like this picture particularly because it has this almost a gothic feeling about it all around you, not just reaching the skies, but also all around you, more universal as an image. And this is how we communicated it with the public. You can see exactly which muscle is on, which one is retracting, which one is relaxing, and which sensor is activated. So this was to explain to the public. Later, we built this with Hyperbody and the company ONL, because there's quite a merge between the two. We built this Festo interactive wall. This is in Festo headquarters in Stuttgart. And they built a full mock-up of an interactive wall that was triggered by the same brains, operated by the same brains we used. And then we had sensors in the base, and passing along those sensors, passing along the wall, would trigger movements. It can also move by itself. So it's a combination of interactive and proactive. It can propose configurations itself, but now triggering a sensor would actually do what you want it to do. Yeah, has more curvature or less curvature. This was made with a very simple application of only a few crystal muscles and a structure that was patented by Pesto. They use that for their flying penguins and flying sea creatures that was built in the way. And then we said, okay, we can use this same system on much larger scale. And this is actually subject to a motto that we derived from the earlier experiments. You don't need an acoustic barrier if there's no train. You only need it when the train is passing. So the idea is there is only a barrier when there is noise. And otherwise, it's a system that can actually move a little bit by itself because it just likes to move. So it's again this interactive and proactive combination. We talked with the Ministry of Holland to realize this, but it never came to execution on this skill, unfortunately. So instead, we focused on real buildings. We focused on building larger structures, but all based on the same principle. And the principle is actually just this one component that has everything integrated. It has the structure, it has the connections, it has the patterns on the surfaces, it has the skin working together with the construction. It has the algorithms driving the geometry, it has the curves, the sketches that come from emotional gestures, actually. And it has the robotic execution, and it has the assembly. And, actually functioning as a standalone structure and creating every possible shape. The interesting notion in this picture is that where you see the holes, it's no more complex than any other part of this structure, which is flat. So flatness or curvature actually follows the same principle. So we can be extremely smooth and rectangular and extremely complex, visually complex in shape, with exactly the same component and the same connections and the same algorithm. In Abu Dhabi, we realized this tower, where we follow the same principle of synchronizing the main structure, steel structure, all prefabricated in large parts, as large as possible, basically, synchronized with the skin that actually follows directly the triangulation and the tessellation of the surfaces that were stretched between the curves driving the whole geometry. This is how you see it from the inside. The client wanted to see the steel, and we wanted the same, and you see the components as well. Everything is visible. And this is a very pleasant environment. It has become, actually, you can look, take the upper window and look up. You can take the lower windows and look down. So you have a great vision all around. In Qatar, where I have been a full professor for a few years, now only function as a consultant for some research project. One of them is food, energy, water. We did a bid on this building, which is an empty building for 10 or 15 years already, not finished, financed by Dubai, but as you know, that all changed since the oil crisis and the blockades between UAE and Qatar. And then we were thinking of how can we actually turn such a building into a complex that is food, energy, water, nexus compliant. So we invented this idea of having food production, energy production, and water production as plugins on top of that non-finished tower. We didn't win the bid, but at least I don't know it yet. I don't think we win it because communication is quite vague sometimes over there. But actually, it could be a system that can be applied to almost anything, existing buildings and new buildings. This is another example of our work, the bigger structures, the cultural complex, the Bauna in Budapest, where we did the parametric design for the body, and we post-parametrized the existing building, knowing that in existing buildings you have bricks that all are different in size, you have windows that all are different in size. So we built families, Revit in this case, using Grasshopper and other software for the new part, and we built families actually as a parametric system to also renovate the existing buildings. This is one of those bigger social spaces, public spaces in the interior, looking back at the city, and you see how it merges. An earlier project before that, where the Bauna was based upon, is the A2 cockpit building in Utrecht in Holland, which is along a highway. You see the red and light stripes of the cars passing by. It's embedded in an acoustic barrier 1.6 kilometer, and here we really started to do on a very large scale the one building, one detail method. One detail for the cockpit and one detail for the acoustic barrier. And that one detail could actually be applied to all the different variations in the geometry. It was very effective. It was very cost effective also. And that is very much due to the fact that we actually brought the engineering back into the architectural office. We did the pro-engineer control of all the curves, of the optimization, and all the relations between the components, the steel components. Again, the steel manufacturers, Meyer Stahlbau, who was a very important figure here, especially also the programmer of the machines, who knew exactly what kind of data he needed for direct programming the production. So unfortunately for engineers like Arup and Happold, we didn't need an engineer for that. It was completely engineered by ourselves and the steel manufacturer. There was nothing else needed. And this is a very direct approach, which makes it so cost effective. So this building was made for the astonishingly cheap, actually, cost of 650 euros per square meter. It's actually the same as a rectangular box, which is quite non-descriptive, would have cost. So one building, one detail in a very extreme form, which is the web of North Holland, later the iWeb, in front of the faculty that later burned down, and also we had to close this one. Assembly of components, all one system, structure, skin, and interior, we had a different system in this case. We had this continuous skin sprayed and insulating skin in the interior to build our protospace laboratory. You see the arena, the collective space to the right, and the private working spaces to the left. It worked very fine until the building collapsed, the main building, and also our lab was shut down, unfortunately. We did with the students in that same period, we did something in the same extremity, one building, one detail, for a new pavilion. Exterior skin, interior skin, we built the components, CNC cutting, so it's all in the same way of working, same method, algorithms, CNC production, robotic production, and assembly, and interacting with that sculpture, which is then the stage for GSF3 that took place in 2016 in Delft, the Game Set Match Conference. So the public and the speakers would interfere and interact with the light conditions and the images you see in the window. Now I want to show you, if I have time, you just let me know how much time I have left. Another extreme,
I think,
application of that one building, one detail paradigm. So for the floors, for the slopes, for the balustrades, for all the load-bearing structures, for all the ceiling parts, we used only one system. In this system, we applied transitions from more closed to more open that could be applied locally. I did this together with one of my bright master students at that time, Arvin Hitting, and with interior designers that actually were responsible for the content of the different passes that were crossing each other to actually explain the food, energy, water nexus. So it's again the food, energy, water nexus that is explained here and actually in an extremely sustainable built form, because also this building would be very sustainable. It has very little detail, so it has no waste in the production process. There's no garbage, it's a very clean building site. So all these factors, which do not count actually in when you measure these, if you are, what is it, silver or gold or platinum status, but actually they do have a lot of effects on this overall sustainability footprint of a structure. So this could well have been done. We were not selected, unfortunately. And this would have been erected that by right by now. It didn't. As you know, Dubai is aiming at having 25% of their buildings 3D printed by 2025. So we were anticipating that idea. But how would you do that? So we thought, okay, we bring the robots on site, we print on site, we use local materials for that, and then we assemble the components. So basically, this strategy on earlier example I showed you, but now using 3D challenge in 3D printing, it's not one component. It's not that. It's actually how you put the things together, because it's about precision. So seeing the form of precision is not. So the question is, how do you actually put things together using 3D? Still be precise when it comes to the connections. And to close this very brief lecture, I chose to have a few examples of participatory design, which involves not only the expert, but also the layman. So also, for example, a project developer or a user or anyone who is representative of some non-governmental organization to participate in the design process. In 1998, we developed this one. It's a game we called a tractor game, and each of those participants, users and experts alike, could play with the sliders. This is Visual Basic and AutoCAD routine in those days. And we would actually be able to quantify and qualify the amount of water, the number of trees, the domains, the living domains where people would live, and then all super and the public domains, and all superimposed. Then you see this master plan image, which looks vague, but is very precise. It contains all the data. It contains exactly how much water there is, how many trees, how many buildings, how many stretches of road, of public zones. One of the things I really want to emphasize here is another is a design quality, that each house in this master plan steps out from their backyard into an ecological zone that is continuous. So basically, you live in a park and you can walk endlessly around and through, or even through the domains. Domains in the interior site are more private, not like gated, but more private for playgrounds, etc. Another example is the variometric house we developed, where the people could actually play with the parameters, with the sliders, to shape their house, to define the size, also play with the curvatures, more leaning backwards, forward, etc., make it bigger, smaller, and developed a web page for that, where you can see the same icons for sloping, for higher, or having an elevation like a first floor, or not having a first floor, and you see the square meters moving with it, and you can easily connect the costs to that as well. So this was a very early example, 2001, I think we did it. That could have a participating platform to co-design a house with the users. And as a last example, I show this, what we are working on now, that is called Participator, not surprisingly, where we define a working space, which is basically a voxelized working space. We work in that working space. And this is urban scale, but could be building scale as well, or furniture scale, doesn't really matter. It depends on the distance between actually the reference points that are later selected by introducing sketches. So this is how we did it. You draw a line, a curve or a straight line, and this line would attract these reference points, a number of them. And we also would apply a randomizer to not attract all the points, but a chosen percentage of points, which makes it more open in structure. And you can see that if you represent a reference point by a cube, by a voxel basically, and then we could assign functions to each voxel, it's completely addressable, each individual voxel or as a group of voxels, and the connected building costs, development costs to this, that then you have a more complicated structure, the building would be would have a higher square meter cost. If you have a very simple one, like for example this one, where everything is very compact, the same number of voxels, by the way, as the previous one, it's very compact, it would have a different cost per square meter. So you could play with very basic volumes, a very basic layout in urban scale, involving the users, project developer, financial experts, anyone you want to have.
Awesome. Really, sorry to
about to
interrupt. We need to
come to the end. I see Christopher speaking, but I don't hear him. This is the last slide. Thank you.
Okay. Thank you so much. Can nobody hear me actually, or was it just Cast that cannot hear me?
We can hear you clear.
Okay, great. So sorry for interrupting, Cas, and thank you very much for this great lecture. Unfortunately, due to the delay in the beginning, we need to move things a little bit back, so we didn't want to cut you off, of course. I think thank you so much, Cas, for being here and being part of EKD.